Okay, this is the introduction to the clutch cylinder work. It's now the 5th of the 6th, 2024. So I've got some notes here. Okay, the problem with the original problem was with the cylinders was that there was a bit of delayed reaction and a bit of clunking going on a few seconds after lifting up the clutch pedal. That has all stopped. The actual travel and the quality of the action of the clutch cylinders is good. However, on the downside, there is a bit of discolouration again after having replaced the clutch cylinders and the rubber line. The only bit that wasn't replaced was this metal line. And in the video, we see that, or I say that there was a bit of rubber or something came out when I blasted this with, I think it was brake parts cleaner. I don't know if it's the rubber that was supplied with the new clutch cylinders. It may not be up to par. That I don't know, but I've got a number of things to point out here. And also a bit of, there was a bit of extra work after the clutch cylinder work, trying to work out why there was a bit of discoloration with the clutch, or the brake fluid. And I'll be putting that video on the end of the clutch cylinder work. So the first thing I'll point out is I did swap over to using .5.1. When we look at the 5.1, it's not really a good day today, but we can see that it's kind of coloured anyway. It's got a slight green tinge to it. This is a bit of paper towel. The paper towel on the left-hand side was dipped into the clutch fluid container just there. Now, I've been using the clutch to go to work and back for, for 2 weeks. So I've been using these clutch cylinders after the work for 2 weeks. So when I say after the work, I mean after having installed them, seen that it's discolouring again, removing the metal line and the lower clutch cylinder and topping it up again with the clutch fluid. So that's 2 weeks of use. Now on the left-hand side, we can see the bit that was dunked into the reservoir. And on the right-hand side, we can see the bit that's been dunked into the new solution, or the solution out of the bottle there. So just on the tip of the left-hand side, we can see that there's a bit of discoloration, but it's actually not too bad. When we look, it looks discolored. However, if I shine a light through the reservoir, we see it's not too bad. That's the solution. We could imagine that if that was filled up higher, that there would be a little bit more of a green tinge to it. Compared to that, there's something going on, I'm not sure. The only thing, as I say, I could do is renew the metal line, which I tried to do, but the bender, the metal line bender wouldn't work, and they could only supply it in a straight length, so it was up to me to bend it, and that didn't work out too well. Probably in the future I will be renewing the metal line. So I'll just say once more that I did remove the lower clutch cylinder, and I used copper grease instead of high temperature grease. I'm pretty sure that copper grease is what you're supposed to use in the components of a brake system. In the video, We did see that there were rubber particles. It seemed to be broken up rubber particles in the old clutch cylinders. So it was definitely time to renew them. So just my thoughts. If I could do this job again, I would probably use the Bosch number one and number two cylinders, just because maybe the rubber would be of a better quality. You know, maybe the discoloration may be okay. It could be part of the running in process of the new cylinders and the rubber. However, it's just a little bit confusing after the initial problem was discoloration of the brake fluid. Okay, so that's it for the introduction. So with this video you're about to watch, there's like the renewing of the number one and number two clutch cylinders. The number one clutch cylinder was very hard to renew. If I could do the job again, I would simply remove the shroud, the clutch pedal shroud, and then renew the number one cylinder. You do need special tools. Those tools, the extensions and the techniques I used are in the video. But that's how you do it. Remove the shroud. The number one cylinder can the nuts can only be removed from the inside. It is a fairly hard job to accomplish. Or I should say difficult. So again, what this video is about is the first bit of work where the cylinders were renewed, and then a kind of a bit of a follow-up work after that. I might be able to put an introduction or just an explanation to the second half or the second part of the work done, which wasn't as much work, but it was just removing the cylinder underneath. And I had to remove the cylinder because the cylinder needs to be removed for the line to be removed. And that's what I was going to do. I was going to replace it just so that I knew everything was renewed. That didn't work out too well, and I reinstalled the metal line. That could be the actual problem with the discoloration. Okay, I won't draw out this video anymore. I think I've included all the information. Maybe in future an AI technology will be able to present my videos in a more timely manner. Okay, thanks for your interest. Okay, we have a 1995 Holden Rodeo with a 2.6 engine in it. Now, when I was using this, it did have a bit of a clutch problem. And usually when I let the clutch out, it would just bottom out and make a noise. However, as I was using it, there came a point when I would let the clutch out and the car would move forward. But then, say, 10 seconds later, I'd hear that clunk of the clutch being let right out. Now, say 6 months ago, I also treated the a lot of rust there. You can see the black paint I put on there. As well as that, in the container, which I've just emptied out, there's a lot of black, seems like dirt in there. It's not very clean at all. And so, because the car's being worked on, I've just done the timing belt, water pump, alternator, and radius rod bushes. I thought this would be a good opportunity to replace the master and slave clutch cylinders. So it's better to do it now than in a situation where it's the only vehicle I've got. So let's have a look at what we have to do. There's two nuts on the inside of the cab, one on the top there and one underneath. We've got a line, a brake fluid line we have to remove. So when we have a look under, and there's the clutch pedal on the left hand side there, we can see what we have to deal with there. And so we can see the frame here that is around the clutch pedal actuator there. And we have 1, 2, 3, 4 nuts on that. So that shroud has to be removed. There's also a travel bolt just there. You can adjust the travel of the travel arm, the clutch travel arm there. So once that's off, then we can hook on to this bit here, where we can probably remove a pin, and we can slide our old master clutch cylinder out. Now, underneath the car, we've got the clutch slave cylinder, and that's it there. So it's got a pin. It's got a pin here that is separate from the cylinder itself. We've got a fairly old line, a fairly old line coming in there. I may have to remove that, but that's it there. Okay, so there's our master clutch cylinder, and that's the slave clutch cylinder that we were looking at underneath the truck. There's some of the brake fluid that came out of the master cylinder. It's not in very good shape, and that's some rags I put into the paper rags I put into the cylinder. Okay, I'm able to get the shroud off, and this is what I'm working with. This is a middle-sized gauge. Just get some light into that somehow. Yeah, so I've got three small extensions, one big extension. I've got a swivel point, and I've got a longer dish socket, 12 millimeter socket. But I have drilled out the back, right? I've sent a, I think, an 8 millimeter drill bit through there. So the thread, the nut's on a thread, and I'll show that in a sec. The thread can go through there, or through there, and it can sit on the end of the swivel point here. So that's what gives me the extra reach there, because let's see now, where are we? The thread there is sticking out. Yeah, so that's the system there. Okay, we can see the socket on there, and it reaches down onto the bolt. Okay, and I'm able to turn the bolt off. Okay, well, this is turning out to be a bit of a weird design, because we can see here the nut is actually on the inside. So that's the nut holding the master cylinder. However, there's a nut up above, and I won't be able to get to that. With the shroud, there's actually a, you might be able to just see it, there's a spring there, and that's connected to the shroud. So the shroud isn't just about this travel
this travel bolt here. There's actually that spring attached. I can't seem to knock that off, and I can't get the top nut off there because I don't have the travel. It hits against the edge here as it unwinds. So don't know if that's on this shot or not, but it's right up the top there. So, well, I'll just try and work out what I'm going to do.
In the engine bay, we don't have any nuts here to undo, so there's only one way, and that's to remove it from the inside. However, on the inside, I just don't have any room to work there. Okay, we've got a big problem here. This is going to take some time. So first of all, I'll just go through the manual. So that's your disassembly. Inspection. And assembly. Okay, they do point out a different way of removing it. Inside the vehicle, remove the retaining clip and clevis pin. Okay, so that makes sense. However, you'll notice here what I pointed out before, that there's no thread and nut on this side. So then it goes on to say, remove the retaining nuts from the master cylinder, but they're on the inside.
So that's one nut there, but the other nut is right up there. And as I move out, we can see now what the problem is. I'm just not able to get any tool up there, and there's too much of an angle to bring out. I just can't reach that nut there. So really, there's very little that can be done. See, all of this
area up under there was put on before the dash was installed in the factory.
Another thing is, you can see the thread. You can see the amount of thread there now. If I put a longer socket on that for the top one, I won't be able to get the reach. There's not all that much room between there and there.
Okay, God has smiled upon me. So I'll show you the system I'm using. Just put some light on that. So
here we have it. So you might be able to see how that goes up there on a swivel point, and you may be able to see the socket extension there. I was able to undo that top nut. So that means that this job can be done.
So, okay, now where's that? Okay, it's all there. Where's the socket? Okay, so it is the 20th of the 8th month of 2023. Now we have a 6.5 millimeter socket if I can make that focus. Okay, that's a 6.5 millimeter socket. It's the smallest type. That's just a little ratchet wrench. I'm putting that onto the drive, onto the end there. I've got, say, 170 long extension onto a swivel point. And then I've got my deep dish 12 millimeter socket, if that'll focus. So that's it there, okay. That's what I purchased. I got that from Bunnings. Okay. Okay, and to get the nuts off, as I say, that's the socket there. I'm just trying to get that focused. And I put an 8mm drill bit through that. Okay, to make it a deeper sitting socket. And that's 9mm across. Okay, and that's able to swivel. And I'm able to unwind the nuts. Now, so far as I can see, I just have to remove that clip and I should be able to get the master cylinder out. I think I've introduced the car. It's a Holden Rodeo TF series. It's a 2.6 engine made in 1995. Okay, so the top nut is out, but for the bottom one I'm using this bigger gauge setup here. I am able to turn the nut out, although that may have been a little bit too much pressure for this smaller gauge here. If you do get into trouble, you may have to strengthen this part here. You may have to go to the shop to get a specific extension bar for this, maybe too small. However, in my case, I was able to undo the top nut. The bottom nut, as I said, is turning on the master cylinder. However, with the top nut, the entire thing came out, including the thread from the master cylinder. Okay, so the next part of this work is to remove this retaining clip here. Now, on the other side, I am able to get the pin out, okay, because up on this side, it is, it's cut out. It's got a cutout for the pin to, for the pin to slide out, okay, just over here. It's got a cutout, so I'll undo the remove this clip now and slide that out. I'll get the bottom nut off and I should be able to remove it and put the new one in. Okay, I'm just going to get a good shot of it now, so we see the pin's been removed. We can see the small shaft there. There may be a washer on the left-hand side. Okay, and we see there is a gap there for the pin to be removed. Okay. But there is that spring there, and I do have to coordinate the shroud here to get the extra clearance, okay, for screwing out these
the screws there holding the master cylinder. Okay, with the master cylinder loose, I was able to crack the nut there for the fluid line, otherwise known as the hydraulic line. That was with a 12mm wrench. This is actually the wrench I got from my RM80 in, I think, 1980. So it's a bit of history. So it's now 43 years old. Okay, what I've done is I've positioned the pedal just out a bit, and up in there there's a larger diameter. You can actually move the clutch backwards and forwards a little bit, so that's created a hole, if you like, a bigger hole to put the pin back in. Now the clutch master cylinder is disconnected at this point. So what's stopping us now is that rubber boot there. So I think what I have to do is just try and prise that back in a little, or either that or lift it up, or spray some lubricating spray on it. Okay, so there it is. At this stage, with rust around the barrel there, that's not something I would attempt to do up. But you can see there's a circlip in there. No doubt, there is a swivel point in there. There's travel. It does look fairly clean inside there. As I say, I did treat this a while ago. But there's rust and contamination somewhere. Okay, well, there's the new one. It's got the same protective cover. The threads. Okay, so the threads are possibly the same. It would be easier if the threads were a little bit, if I did cut a little bit off at this stage. But, well, let's try and install it first of all with the same thread. Okay, I've wound this out to be the same as that. They are identical, so at this stage I can check this clamp and do up this nut. I got this on eBay. It's not that strong. It's come in handy a few times. Okay, so that's the same. That's done up. This one. Okay, it's ready to go in. I'm tossing up whether or not I should take a bit of that off. It is, as we've worked out, it is the same as it was before. Okay, I've painted some black rust paint around the mating surface there. I've used a heat gun to
try to get the paint to cure a little bit. I'll put some lube spray around the rubber seal. If not, I'm probably going to have to take it off and pass it through separately. Okay, with a bit of lube spray, it did in fact pass right through.
Okay, so the new master clutch cylinder is it's installed. And it's lined up there, so I'll go ahead and put this this pin through.
Okay, this wasn't easy. The positioning of the light had a lot to do with the success. So I've got that shining that way, this one shining that way.
Now, in there, there's a metal bushing that sits in this. The pedal shaft here. I just don't want to drop the camera. Okay, so that's going to come out a few times, but I pushed it in the bushing from this side. Once I was able to get this locked around the bushing, I was able to get it in this side of the the clutch cylinder arm here, and I was able to move this around. I don't know how exactly I got it to go in, but I did eventually get the bushing in and this this holding pin through here. Now I've got the hole exposed, but it's just not easy. There's no easy way. Just make sure that the bushing will fall out a few times, but if you get your light positioned properly, and if you've got good vision, of course, that helps. Just keep the bushing in there and move the pedal as you're trying to get the pin in. This took me half an hour, by the way.
Okay, what I have to do now is get the line off, and it goes down in behind there against the firewall, and you might be able to see down right down there where it's joined onto the car. So I have to work out, I might have to jack the car up and just find out. And so I'll remove this hydraulic line now. That has to be clean, that's going to be reused. And also, I've seen on videos, you do have to get the thread started, okay, in the first and second clutch cylinders. Okay, we're under the car now. So we've got the joiner here that holds the line. It turns into rubber further down. The way to undo this bracket here is with a nut. You may be able to just see it on the left hand side there. So it's kind of hard, very hard to point out, but it's just up in on the left hand side. Yeah, you can just see it there. So in undoing that, that'll free up the line. And I undo this banjo bolt here on the slave master cylinder or the second unit, and that'll give me my line, and then we can replace this and secure the top, the first cylinder up the top. I have decided to just leave the line. This car, as you can see, it probably, you know, how much more How many more kilometres will it do? I don't know, but probably, maybe not all that many. It is going to be a spare car, so it's just going to be sitting there waiting to for its time to be used. So I've decided just to leave the line where it is. At this stage, while the unit was out from the firewall, I did get the flare nut, we'll call it, started. So the line is connected to the first unit there. And so now it's pushed in. It's supported with a piece of block, just holding it in against the firewall. And we'll reassemble in the cab. So we'll reassemble in the cab. I've got one new nut there that just happened to appear out of nowhere. And the others are spares from another job. As I think I pointed out, the original nuts didn't go onto this thread. This is a more of a coarse thread. So I had to fish around for what I had. And I've got these nuts to choose from. As I said, that new one, just honestly, it just appeared from nowhere. I found it in a packet, but it could have been lying on the bench close to where the other nuts were. So, okay, let's reassemble. Okay, the issue I'm having at the moment is with getting the top nut back on. Just up there, I just don't have the room. The back of the swivel, the socket can get the nut on there, but it's not parallel to the thread, and it knocks on this spring here. So I just, even with this small gauge, I don't have the clearance. So what I might do next weekend is undo the clip and disconnect this connector, let that drop down, and maybe try and just build out a bit more clearance by undoing these nuts. The thing about it is there's no, I don't know about the thread. If you go in the engine bay, there's no presence of any sort of anchor points for the thread. So yeah, with the shroud, as you can see, the shroud sits, the shroud mounting points would be there, there, there and there, but there's nothing that I can see. So I just don't know how that would affect the threads. Okay, well, I think I can see where I went wrong with this work. I should not have made this connection here. This should be dropped down to allow me to get to the top nut there and do this up. Now, at that point, I would have to tighten up the nuts to bring this in and reconnect, and then do up the shroud. I think that's what I'm supposed to do. With the hydraulic line here and this threaded in, this line is supporting the first cylinder there, so it won't drop. I don't know if I've shown the old master cylinder. This is where I've treated the rust before, inside the cap. It doesn't appear to be too bad, although there is some rust in a hole just there. We can see the original rust that was inside the cab. There is flexing, and there is two stages. It's a two stage, so it goes sort of to there and then through that. Okay, so the top nut is now on. You can see it just there that it's on. Now, to do that, as I said, I disconnected this. I disconnected all of the bolts off the shroud, the top, the bottom, this one. Now, the top one, you may just be able to see it there. I'm trying to look for it in the camera. This is pretty tough. Okay, there it is there, I think, or over there. Anyway, the top nut started to bind as I undid it, and I just didn't want to risk taking it right off. So undoing the other nuts allowed me to move the shroud as far forward as I could. Now, there's a second type of technique I use to get the top nut on. I changed over to a thicker, more robust gauge. It has the same socket on there, but with this gauge I was able to sort of push it up level against the spring. See, I was fighting against this spring here. Okay, so the back of the swivel would hit the back there of the spring, and it wouldn't allow me to get the nut on because it was on an angle. So this is a different one from the system I used to remove the nut. Is completely different to the system I used to put the nut back on. So as I said, this is more robust, and I'm able to push against that spring. So there's your socket. There's your swivel point. And then I've got these this adapter. And then I've got these extensions. Okay, well, the shroud is now off. I suppose that's possibly what I should have done in the first place, but I didn't want to undo anything I didn't have to. I'm now able to do up the two nuts to secure the master cylinder. I can spray some lube on those threads. It may be a good thing I did take it off, because it could have disturbed the spring on the shroud. So I'll show the shroud now. Okay, there's the shroud. So there's the hole. How was it situated? It was situated like that, and we got the bushing in through there, and we're able to put the clip on. There's the other side of it there. Now, you can see the spring there. It seemed to have come loose. It sits in that notch there. So it's a matter of bringing the arm up like that and just moving it up, and it will go in that retaining hole there. Now, so far as I can see, there's nothing holding the spring in. It can just come out. Oh, hello, puss. Hello, puss. Hello. That's the tabby cat from next door. See ya, puss. Yeah, so that'll go in there. Have to make sure that's in there at least. So when the pedal's pushed in, what happens? It falls out, does it? Seems to fall out. Okay, well that's not good enough. So all right. Well, I have to look into that and see what I'm supposed to do there. Okay. Well, as we can see,
That's all tightened up. That's ready to go.
And that's what I had to use. A deep socket. I think it's a 12 millimeter. I better make sure. Yes, a 12 millimeter socket. And because it's only got the small gauge joiner at the back, there I use a small gauge swivel socket or swivel and a converter and the extensions and the ratchet wrench. So with the shroud off, that's what I needed to do up the nuts, and you will have to remove the shroud. Now the thing about the shroud is it has this spring, and the spring pops out if the travel is too far. Okay, so you see it here, I'll put it into place. So if the arm goes too far, in fact the whole thing comes out. So there's something up there. Okay, so what I've done is I've put two plastic ties around the spring, so the spring goes in through there and back. So I've got these two plastic ties keeping that round bit held back, and so what that allows it to do is it will go its full treble without the spring falling out. Okay, so I'm assuming that so the spring's doing its job, but it's just that it won't flip out. So I'm assuming that the full travel is only about from there to there, right? And the spring wouldn't fall out anyway, but I like to be sure. I'm going to put some grease on this point here, just so there's less wear and tear on the plastic. These plastic ties are quite strong and hardy, but I'll snip that off and give it some lube and put it back on. Okay, well, now we've got our spring. It's not moving up and down in this retainer here. This is just to stop the spring end that pokes through from moving up and down. We now have a more progressive travel. Also, our spring's not popping out because we've got our plastic tires there. So, and the other side's good, where the spring end goes through. So, that's ready to be put on. So, I did have to do a fair amount of experimenting and nuts and bolts seeking, but it should be good. Okay, at this point,
it's ready to be, the shroud's ready to be put on. So I've backed off the nut here, so this can be adjusted, and I'll install the shroud. Okay, well, it's all back in place. I just need to put this connector on, probably next weekend. And
just another quick rundown. So, swivel socket, but you'll need this adapter. Okay, that's a drill connector, and that's a small joiner there. To be honest, I don't really know exactly what it's called, but it's the smallest, and with this ratchet on the end there. Now I will need a 12 millimeter deep socket, but I'll need the next step up to join onto that, so that I can get the torque onto the nuts on the shroud. So yeah, it's just got a swivel socket. I'm pretty sure I've gone through this one before. I turned it on with this that winder, and you've got your adapters. So that's what it is. Okay, that's what I used to tighten the nuts up. I did go and get this 12 millimeter deep well socket. So that's a 3/8 drive, and that's on a swivel socket. And this is a 3/8 extension unit and ratchet, and that's what I had to have to do the nuts up. Now, getting the nuts up underneath the dashboard, what you can do is get some grease, any old grease, and just put some grease around the edge of the nut. Put the nut on the socket extension or the socket, and that will keep the nut there and it won't drop off. So that's how I did it. Now these have this plastic tab inserted there, and I suppose is to guard against theft. What will happen is this will break off and it'll leave the plastic inside. How I got that was I just got this. I put on some gloves first of all, then I sort of picked it out, then I used this small to mid-sized screwdriver and I pried it out. It did come out eventually, and then I was able to remove it with these pliers. You know, what would you do if you couldn't get it out? Just take it back, get a refund, and get them where you purchased it to take it out. That's what I'd do. So between all of that, you can put the nuts on the shroud. Okay, some very important information here. So you're better off giving this job to a mechanic, but if you do take it on, how I position this the same distance out, this arm here, or this U clamp, that has to be put beside the original one, and the distance out, you have to make it the same as the original one, because the reason being is that you can't turn this U connector point here once the shroud is on. So to adjust this out, you would need to take the shroud off, then put the shroud on, see if it's okay. If it's not, you'd have to take the shroud off again and turn it in the direction you needed to go, and then put the shroud back on. Now that would be very time consuming. As it happens, I adjusted mine to the factory unit, and that happens to be okay. So that's all connected. I had to take the grease off and reinsert the bushing because the U clamp here wouldn't pass through until the bushing was completely level and the grease was taken off. Then I put the pin through and connected the clip there. Okay, so I know this video is going to be long and drawn out, but as I've always said, the only real possibility to present this information properly is probably an AI quantum computer. So, okay, so the inside now is now finally finished, and we'll move to the outside. Okay, at this stage, because this was put on before, because the line was put on before, the nut is tightened up. So that means the number one cylinder is complete, and now we go down and do the number two cylinder. Okay, so there it is.
It looks like a much easier job. There's two nuts, one there and one above somewhere. The line has been taken off. I'll spray that with cleaner. So, and then I'll take this number two cylinder off. It's important to grease in this dish here and probably here. So I'll remove that now. Okay, so there's a better look at the unit and the two bolts. Okay, well here it is. Just get some light on the subject. So we might be able to see that sort of gunky stuff. That's not a good sign. It did have the boot on it, so that just sits in that cup there. It's very hard to see how much of this is being picked up, but that has to be lubricated, otherwise apparently I've heard that it makes a squeaking noise. So that just sits in there, the boot goes over that, but we've got this gunk there, and that sits against the clutch actuator on the gearbox. So that's it. I can see some, no, it's pretty clean in there. So just pan around it quickly. And that's the rod and the boot. Okay, so I've just put some grease on there. That should sit inside this point, the boot, this boot area here. So, just trying to get that to seat. But I'll put a bit more grease there. And there is grease in the dish there. Okay, we do have a plug that has to come out. And we've got our boot here. Now I just have to get the boot lip over onto this area here. I don't think it's going to be particularly easy. Okay, so there she is. She's all set up. Yes, that did go on. I just I got one piece in and I just pushed it forward and around. Then I got the grease out and it's ready to go on. Okay, there it is. It's holding itself in place. The bolts are not in yet. So I'll go ahead and put the bolts in and torque up the banjo bolt. And then it's on to the brake bleeding.
Contrary to popular belief, it didn't take very long at all. Somebody just pushed the clutch pedal in and then brought it out, because it doesn't have a spring, so it has to be manually pushed in and taken out. And I undid the bleeding nib on the number two cylinder, and it didn't take long at all. In fact, probably as little as seven pumps. But just remember to keep the reservoir, this reservoir, don't allow it to empty out. Okay, at this point, the number one and number two clutch cylinders, the first lot of the clutch cylinder renewal work is complete. But then, unfortunately, there's a bit of discoloration with the brake fluid in the clutch brake fluid reserve cylinder, and I start to do another inquiry into what the problem is. As I said, I did try and renew the metal line. That didn't go too well, so it was reassembled. So only time will tell what the actual problem is. As the years roll on, I will renew the metal line in about 2 years when the rodeo goes back into storage. So, you know, this video is mainly for people doing the same work and people that are interested in this type of discoloration, what the problem is, whether, as I say, whether it's the rubber in the clutch cylinders or the metal line. As I say, at this point, everything's renewed except the metal line. You know, the rubber line that the metal line hooks onto and then goes into the number two cylinder is renewed. The number one, the number two cylinders are renewed. So time will tell. Thanks for your interest. Okay, a video replacing the clutch line on a 1995 Isuzu Holden Rodeo with a 2.6 in it, TF model. So I've recently replaced the master and slave clutch cylinders, or we'll call it number one, number two clutch cylinders. So that's actually a new one. That's a new one. I drove the car for about a month, and then it started to rust. So the line's off it at the moment. It usually comes up and down here. To do this job, you'll need to remove the front wheel, put the car on blocks, put the car up on pine blocks or hardwood blocks for safety. Okay, and there's the other one back there. I've also got a catch safety system at the front of the car. As well as that, the car's got bricks behind the front wheels and on the other side. And of course, it's tested for safety. Okay, so I try and rock it with my arm, and it's secure. Okay, then I know I can safely come underneath the car. Okay, looking here, I've just replaced the starter motor, and that's why I'm doing this work now. There's nowhere here where you can actually get your hands to work past any area there, so you'll have to come around and underneath. Okay, so there's the new clutch mass secondary cylinder on the gearbox, and you can see that's badly rusting as well, so I have to remove that and treat that rust. Now, for the clutch line itself, the clutch line, it hooks on to there, and that up there, that's where the plastic clip goes, okay, and the retaining clip, supportive clip goes there, and then the rubber hose connects here to that screw there on the master cylinder. Okay, so you'll need to jack the car up. Okay, that's the number one and number two clutch cylinders. That's the information. That's the shop I got it from, and this is eBay. And this is the new clutch line. So this is for the metal line. I got this made up. I went into the shop and I had the the metal line and the rubber line make it Warringah brake and clutch. So the metal line was $32. That's the line and the threads, or the compression join. And the clutch hydraulic hose was $50. Okay, as we can maybe see here, I did write it twice because sometimes I expect things to happen, and it's happened here. Something's not too good. Might be able to see there the 3rd of the 8th, 23. The rodeo's been in storage, but it's around about the, I'd say, the 11th of the 12th, 23. So, coming around here, I'll just get a light. I did put a bit of grease in the cup for the shaft. I've removed the cap, and you can see the clean grease there, but there's also that black around the edge. The brake fluid that came out is dirty, so I'm just going to try to remove. I might try and get a light, a better light. Okay, so there seems to be this dirt in there. It's not the it's not the grease. That's the grease there. The grease is good, but there's this other perishing there's this other, what is that, grease, or is it their grease, their assembly grease, or because that's, you know, I'm not really sure. When we look down into the bore, that looks fairly clean. But, you know, what's caused that black rubber looking around the rim there? That was definitely a type of grease or broken down rubber or something. Just trying to get that light. It's very difficult to get that light to shine down in there. Yeah, no, I just can't. I don't have three hands. Now, unfortunately, that's not grease. That black... I'll put some fuel. I mixed some fuel with it. And it didn't disperse. It just sort of smeared around. So that's... I'm pretty sure that that's the rubber breaking down. There's only one other thing it could be, and that's... The rubber from the line is bad, and it's in the cylinder, and it's making its way out, but I can't see how, because not even the rubber would get past there, because rubber is thicker than brake fluid, and anything coming out of there, that is to say, anything coming out of there, you would think that the brake fluid would come out first, not a rubber solution. Another thing, when I cleaned out the metal line, the reason I'm replacing it is because I noticed a dirty solution come out of there. So anyway, while we're at it, there's the new rubber line that I had this made up at the shop. And this is the metal line, so they don't bend it, okay? And I've got this pipe bender. I got that on eBay for a reasonable price. Okay, it is fairly big, so there's the pipe in relation to the bender. And that just gets bent like so. Oh, while I'm at it, that's the plastic clip. Okay, now I thought it wouldn't release, because I don't want to tip that over. Just excuse me, just bear with me, please. So there's the clip, and there's the metal line, so I'll just get some light on that. Okay, so the metal line goes in the clip. You'll find this clip up underneath at the highest point, and so it snaps in pretty easy. Now you would think that there's no way that's going to come out, because this is fairly hard plastic, and as you can probably see, it's fairly, if I focus that, it's fairly thick. But in actual fact, if you press against it and bring it the other way, it will release. Okay, especially if you can get like your finger behind it. I know there's very limited room, but it's a possibility that you don't have to snap it off. Okay, now what do I do? Do I put it back on and then it fails when it's a spare car, by the way? When I'm desperate from a spare car and I'm using it on the road and it fails, this is not something that you can just do on a weekend. Especially getting the master cylinder out of the above the accelerator and clutch area, there's no working room there. So what do I do? It was very strange that I had that rubber solution up around the top there. The grease was supposed to go in the bowl, but that was clearly not the grease I put in around the edge, because that was a different type of material. So this is the way I look at it. The pipe could possibly be bad, but this rubber could have perished. So what I'm going to have to do, I've got the other, this is a spare car, so I'm not relying on it. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to have to slice this and see what's inside. If there's anything loose inside, well, that will explain it. One of the frustrating things is that I replaced the first and second clutch cylinders because I had dirty brake fluid in the reservoir, in the clutch reservoir. And then I put new ones in. They're both rusted up, you know, in about a month. And I've still got dirty brake fluid. Now, the hose itself is good. I'm going to have to just adjust my light a bit there. And possibly, I can't focus it, but that's actually good. I might have to. So this is no doubt the original hydraulic hose, and it's actually very good. There's no, you know, the rubber's not breaking down at all. It's actually very good. Now, the problem's not going to be in the metal line, because it was a greasy type of substance. And the only thing we've got is either they've put a special type of grease in there when building the unit. And I'll go and have a look at that now. But that shouldn't have worked its way into the brake fluid. Okay, I ran a video when installing the second master cylinder. That's how the old master cylinder came out, and we see there's a similar type of grease. Now, I don't know if they use that in assembly or not. I'm now going to film the old unit.
On the subject, so you might be able to see that sort of gunky stuff. That's not a good sign. It did have the boot on it, so that just sits in that cup there, being picked up. But that has to be lubricated, otherwise, apparently.
While we're here, we can see the new. The one we're working with now, and compared to the old one, and it's now, we're still in the 12th month, so this is only about 3 months ago. Okay, so the only thing we found is the grease in the secondary cylinder, or the cylinder on the gearbox that could possibly discolour the brake fluid. Okay, now I have to bend this the same as this. Chances are this is fine. I'd say 90% this is fine. There could be some rust inside, but looking at this, I'd say that would be highly unlikely, especially considering just how clean this part, the rubber part, was. That's absolutely... perfect after 28 years or less. But anyway, I've got this line now. I did pay reasonable amount of money, I think around $35 for it, so I'll have a crack at it anyway. But while we're at it, let's have a better look at this this fluid that I got out of the secondary cylinder there. It seems to have some sediment in it. It's a little bit challenging to film it, but we can probably see there that there's some of that rubber-like substance underneath the fluid there. We'll tip it out, we might be able to see better how it sort of disperses there. With some focus, it might show up better. Okay. So what that's saying to me is that area there, that black substance, it seems to have worked its way back down into the cylinder. Well, I was told that it was easy to bend, but unfortunately, as we can see there, that's not really right, because that's kinked. So what happens is you sort of bring this up and out. I'm just going to try and get some more light on that. And maybe, I don't know, if I'd use the... Let's try this. I was using this ridge. So the second size, but let's try the smaller one, and we'll see what happens there. I can see now. Okay, so that's not a bad bend. So that's what you do. You use the smaller one there. The bigger one, that's, as we'll probably see, there. Okay, this time I've used some copper grease, and I've put that in the dish there. And some around the edge here. So copper grease won't bind when rubber's on it. And other grease under hot conditions will turn into a type of plastic, especially the blue stuff. So this should... Yep, perfect. There we have it. It's amazing what difference it makes when you work with the right stuff. Okay, so I'm going to use the old line. I've got a bit of Teflon tape around that, or this plumber's tape. That's just to stop any rust or anything seeping down there, and to make a good join. So, okay, let's put it on. Okay, I've got the top joined on of the line, and I've got everything situated, and so now I need to get the angle of this join. If I can just get it on video, yeah, so it's how this will line up, so the line comes down there. I've just put a bit of marking paint there. I've got to remove it now to do that up. Okay, now that I've got the right angle here in this compression joint, I can do that up. Just got to make sure that's not moving. Okay, I'm happy. Got some new washers for the banjo bolt. So I'll get that done. There's Teflon tape there. Just a reminder not to put this, we'll get this Teflon tape into the brake line. Just be careful with that. So I'll just remove this Teflon tape. Put the new washers on, or thread it through. It does, when you put this line on, it does have to go up against the frame of the car. I'll show that after. Okay, so when the line's threaded in, it has to go down behind the canister there, and mainly you can maybe able to see this line here. It has to go behind that, so it's got to follow along the body of the car. Okay, the line's on. So I use Teflon. There's Teflon there at the base of the fuel pressure gauge. Just whatever you do, don't go past the end of the thread, and don't get it in the line. I'll film it from underneath. Okay. So there we are. When I said I had to bring it through along the car body, that's what I meant. Otherwise, you'll go on the wrong side of this or these brake pipes here. Okay, so underneath the car, we've got this retaining screw here for the bracket. And then I've done up the nut for the secondary cylinder there. Unfortunately, when they made this here, you'll see that the dowel pin doesn't line up with the hole. You can probably see the hole there behind the dowel pin. But it doesn't really move when you tighten it up, just so long as you get started on the right angle. So that's central to this this round bit. Okay, I've written just a simple instruction here. So when I close the bleeding valve on the brake line, I can bring the pedal up and vice versa. So to push down, I open the bleeding valve so I don't get confused. Open the pedals down, so I close it, bring it up, and I open it to push the pedal down. Okay, I'm happy to report that despite all these problems, the clutch system as a whole is working very well. In time to come, say in a couple of years, I will renew the metal line. If once the metal line is renewed, the brake fluid still becomes dirty, then it's definitely the seals in the cylinders. So for the real test, after the metal line is replaced, the car would have to be, it would have to do the 2 years and then go back out on the road again. That could take 3 or 4 years. However, if you're watching this in the future, drop me a line and I can tell you how the car went. Thanks very much if you've watched to this point. It's greatly appreciated. Thanks for your interest. Over and out.